And last but not least, I want to introduce our keynote speaker this evening, Janette Sadik-Khan. So Janette served as the commissioner of the New York City DOT from 2007 to 13. And in that time, I think it's not an overstatement to say that she completely changed the way the entire country thinks about transportation, from how we move to how we actually deliver projects. It was just a total sea change. And she implemented an ambitious program to improve safety, mobility, and sustainability, ensure a state of good repair on the city's roads, bridges, and ferries. She had a budget of $2.8 billion, which sounds like a lot, but given how big New York City is, it's probably less than she would have liked. While she was there, she had to be very thrifty as well. So she worked a lot with temporary materials. She pedestrianized Times Square, redesigning 2.3 miles of Broadway from Columbus Circle to Union Square. She planned and launched 7 select bus routes. She launched the nation's largest bike sharing system with 330 stations and 6,000 bikes, City Bike. It became an entirely new transit system. 40,000 people a day use City Bike. So that's more people each day using City Bike than use Link Light Rail here in Seattle. So it's a real transit system. Both of them are. She also developed and published New York City's first ever street design manual and street works manual, defining new standards for creating more resilient and attractive streets. And now she's at Bloomberg and Associates. She's working with mayors around the world to reimagine and redesign their cities. And on a personal note, I had a brother that lived in New York for years, and I was living in DC. And so I would say every 4 to 6 weeks, I would hop on the bus, or I would hop on Amtrak, and I would go up to New York to visit him, because New York's a much more exciting place to visit than DC. And it was really interesting, because I remember the first time I saw the 9th Avenue protected bike lane, and it was like this complete revelation about what a city street could look like. And then every time I came back, there was something new. And I could just see it, just in those trips, I could see how quickly somebody or a city could change the way it looked and felt and interacted with its residents. And so with that, we're all delighted to have Janette here to talk to us about the future of transportation. And I'd like to have you all join me in welcoming her. Thank you.
Wow, this is great. Well, I think it's appropriate that Scott is talking about his revelations, because I feel like we're in like the Church of Sustainable Streets here. You know, it's like you're all on these pews. I'm not used to this. It's really great. Much grittier in New York. Thanks, and it is really great to be here in Seattle at this really critical moment in time. To talk about some of the lessons that we learned in transforming the streets of New York City. But before we get started, I want to get a sense in the room. How many of you have been to New York City in the last 5 years? Okay. How many of you have been to New York City in the last 2 years? Oh my God. All right. How many of you were in New York City last year? Actually, it turns out I'm talking to an audience of New Yorkers. Wow. Either that or our tourism program is working super well. So that's great. Well, I was going to say, for those of you that haven't been, I was going to give you an official invitation, but you've all come. But since you've come, you know how big the changes have been over the last 7 years. And in just a few years, New York City has become a different city. It's got a different vocabulary, different designs. In fact, New Yorkers have actually become fluent in the language of sustainable streets. You know, they're very comfortable talking about protected bike lanes, pedestrian plazas, wayfinding systems. And I think it's fair to say that a city that was once known for its mean streets, we've made them much nicer in close to real time. And in New York City, like you, we have an awful lot of infrastructure. We have 6,000 miles of streets, we have 12,000 miles of sidewalks, We have 12,000 signalized intersections and the largest passenger ferry system, one of the largest in the nation. And you certainly know something about that here, certainly the ferry part. And really, given the breathtaking beauty of Seattle, and it really is, I don't know whether you just did something special for today. It was one big tease, you know? I was actually having trouble adjusting to the high oxygen content. So for me, it's really no surprise that you're one of the fastest growing cities in the United States. And it's called the Emerald City for a reason, and you know why. But I think the challenge is ensuring that world-class mobility and affordability and quality of life are available to everyone here and beyond the glittering core that we have downtown. And it is really impressive to see the work that is underway. I had the opportunity to travel with Scott's team and went around and saw the impressive transit expansion projects underway. And it's really impressive. And everyone knows that it requires really hard work to get beyond the kind of dashboard view of our streets that we've had for so long. And you know, when you think about it, for years, leaders have looked at streets like this and said, yep, working just fine. You know, and it's really hard to remember that our streets didn't used to always be that way. We used to have more shared streets. I mean, our streets were really, you know, like storefronts and sidewalks. They were like extensions, you know, of our rooms. And this was actually Lower Manhattan in 1900. And, you know, Pioneer Square wasn't that much different. And this shift to the automobile didn't just happen. It actually happened by design. And you can see this in the planning documents for New York City in 1922. I love this. First step, pedestrians are removed. Second step, cars invade. It's like Venice, but with traffic sewers instead of canals. By the 1920s, it was really hard to imagine even crossing the street in places like Grand Army Plaza in Brooklyn. And it really only got worse from there. The industrial design that we had from Detroit really became the main consideration in shaping American cities and American streets. And automakers spent much of the 20th century convincing us that we had this love affair with the automobile, when in fact, I really think it was more of an arranged marriage. And this worldview was all about moving as many cars as possible from point A to point B, and it ignored all the other ways that a street was used. And this is Times Square, actually, in the 1950s. And this is it 60 years later. This was before we did our design. And you can see that not much has changed. Our streets have been really in suspended animation, and you see that here. And when you think about it, think about how technology has so completely transformed our lives. You know, and yet our streets have this kind of, we're like in dial-up mode. You know, there's just nothing new. So New York finally shattered this status quo with Mike Bloomberg, Mayor Bloomberg's Plan YC sustainability plan, which he launched in 2007. And it recognized that if we were going to continue to grow and thrive and accommodate the million more people that were expected to be here in 2030, we had to fundamentally change the way we did business and to work toward the streets we wanted and not just this Stone Age system that we'd actually inherited. And really, to make real change requires vision, it requires political courage and leadership, like people like Mayor Murray, people like Commissioner Kubly, the Move Seattle campaign, and the voters of this city are a huge part of this change. You need to have a vision. You can't move the big ship of a city without having a vision. And so one of the first things that we did in New York City at DOT was we developed a strategic plan. And it really created this new roadmap for our streets. We really focused on building safe streets, making it easier to walk around, bike around, take the bus. You know, and these ideas aren't new. These aren't new strategies. But what was new was the time frame in getting it done, the speed of delivery. And this is really important because at the time we were making these changes, New Yorkers actually didn't believe that our streets could actually change at all. You know, we are on our fourth groundbreaking of the Second Avenue subway, right? Fourth groundbreaking. So we feel your birth of pain. So instead of wading through years and years of planning studies, we actually use paint and stones and planters to change our streets in real time. And it gave New Yorkers the sense of what was possible, tangible. You know, they could see, touch, and feel these changes in real time. And the proof of this concept wasn't a computer model, but it was in real world performance. And if it didn't work, you know, you could put it right back to the way that it was. And nobody could argue that our streets were working so well that we didn't want to experiment at all. So we worked citywide. This is one of our first projects in Dumbo. How many of you have been to Dumbo? Of course you've been to Dumbo. You're very cool. So what we did is over a weekend, we just painted this underutilized lot, turned it into a plaza, tables and chairs, and whoosh, it was there. And it was a huge success. In fact, in the 3 years since we implemented it, 172% increase in retail sales there. This is what we did in the financial district. Again, just, you know, in the financial district downtown, very narrow sidewalks, very hard to have cafes. And so we built a pop-up cafe. Places like Madison Square, you all know Madison Square, Flatiron Building, everybody takes pictures. People used to squat down trying to take pictures and, you know, worried about getting killed by cars. Also the largest, widest intersection in New York City there. And so we decided to do something about it, and we, you know, created this plaza, coned it off. It was unbelievable to see. You can see these orange cones. You know, people just whoosh came into this plaza. This was an art class that just came like within 2 hours of our putting out the barrels. Unreal, unreal. So, you know, New Yorkers are terribly hungry for public space. And today it is one of the most popular public spaces in the city. And people, I love this, people often choose to sit in the plazas rather than sitting, the park is to the right there, they sit in the plazas rather than sitting in the park just to experience and feel the energy of the city. So these plazas are in demand all across the city, and we did them in all sorts of different kinds of neighborhoods, creating more pedestrian space, making it safer to get around. This is at the foot of the Williamsburg Bridge, which used to be just a tsunami of traffic and danger. And we created more pedestrian crossings. We created these plazas, made it much easier for you to cross the street again before and after. And so, again, just paint and planters, just you can move really quickly. And in 6 years, we created 60 plazas. We have 60 plazas underway. You can see that in the map, all sorts of different neighborhoods, all sorts of different partnership models. Mayor Bloomberg believed that we couldn't create public space unless we had maintenance agreements in place. In the 1980s, New York had created a lot of public space, but nobody took care of it, and they turned into garbage pits, and they were ugly and horrible. And so now we have maintenance agreements in all of the plazas and public spaces that we set up, and maybe in the Q&A we can go over some of the different models because we have different models for different parts of the city. So the program was set up. You can see the top left was the before the change, then the temporary change, and then the permanent project. This is in Willoughby Plaza in Brooklyn. Again, if we had gone through the traditional construction process, it takes 5 years to get through it, you know? And so to be able to show the world of the possible quickly is a really important strategy. And the program went well beyond plazas. It was really about creating a new road order. And this is Broadway, and you can see we provided acres of new space for residents and tourists and workers there that were really drawn to the shops and the restaurants. And in project after project, it became quite clear that better streets mean better business. So we would take traffic choke streets like this. This is on 34th Street, right by, right in front of Macy's. And we really kind of created this miracle on 34th Street. I know it's hokey, but I love that line. So we saw foot traffic increase 6% in just 6 months. It was astonishing. So probably our biggest example of this was Times Square. And before our project, we had 354,000 people going through Times Square every day. And yet 90% of the people going through it were on foot, but they only had 10% of the space, complete imbalance. You know, and New Yorkers are kind of crazy when it comes to getting around, you know? We start to vibrate if we can't move. And so what would happen is, like, you'd have people, you know, that would come, you and your families come to Times Square. You may be walking four people abreast, and, you know, we start to kind of go crazy. And so we would actually rather get, you know, hurt and run into the street to get around you, you know, rather than be on the sidewalk. So we would trade the safety of the sidewalk for the street just to get by. So it was terribly dangerous. And, you know, New Yorkers, it's so funny. When I first started at DOT, turns out there was this, like, you know, we've got these crowded sidewalks, so we are actually, you know, it's one of the marks of a world-class city, a great, great walking city, so lots of people out walking. And so, actually, on Fifth Avenue, a guerrilla team of artists dressed up in New York City DOT vests and gear and hats, and they actually went out there and they painted the middle of the sidewalk on Fifth Avenue. And on one side, they wrote visitors, and the other side, they wrote New Yorkers. And, you know, everybody loved it. In fact, people came up to me and said, what a great idea. Unbelievable. So the area was dangerous. It was underperforming. It was horrible. So in 2009, I brought this idea to Mayor Bloomberg that we were going to close Broadway to cars from 42nd Street to 47th Street. And I might add, this was in an election year. But he didn't blink. His motto was really, trust in God, and everybody else bring data. So we brought lots and lots of data. Data on traffic speeds, data on safety, data on economic performance. And we made it clear that this was going to be a pilot program. And if it didn't work, we would put it back. And if it worked, we would keep it. And this went a really long way to reducing the anxiety that people felt about these changes. And remember, this is like we've got lots of theater owners, Broadway, stores, hotels. So, you know, giving people the opportunity to see, touch, and feel these changes was really key. Any big project, you know a little bit about that here, there can be surprises along the way. And so I remember, you know, we had closed off we're a little anxious, it's kind of a big project, closing this off, everybody's watching, and we looked out and we realized there's nothing there. Like, we've closed it off, but there's nothing there. What are we gonna do? Oh, stupid, really stupid. And so we worked with Tim Tompkins, who's headed the Times Square Alliance, the bid there, and we went to Pinchink Hardware Store, and we bought really cheap beach chairs. And we put all these beach chairs out there. And it became this instant sensation with these beach chairs. It was fantastic. And all of the press talked about the beach chairs, the beach chairs, the beach chairs. And nobody talked about the fact that we'd closed Broadway to cars. So it was fantastic. So if you've got a big project, Scott, it's beach chairs. So it was a big success. People came out immediately, and these chairs became this new symbol of Times Square. They had this, like, you know, it's usually I Heart New York, but there was I Beach Chair Times Square, which I loved. And, you know, all sorts of performances of every sort of type, big mobility and safety benefits. We had 80% fewer people walking in the street, and pedestrian injuries went down 35%, motorist injuries went down 63%, even as driving times in Midtown, which is one of the most congested parts of the city, fell. So it was a home run on every regard. And you can see this here. It was also an economic blockbuster. Six major stores moved in, retail sales doubled. And according to Cushman and Wakefield, it's one of the top 10 retail locations on the planet. So, and aside from the mayor, the bid was one of our strongest partners, Tim Tompkins, and he did a great job of getting the local landlords on board, and a really terrific job at programming. And I encourage you, the next time you're in New York, check out what's going on in Times Square, because there's always something really cool. It could be a yoga class, it could be volunteer projects, it could be open air opera. You know, and when you think about it, it's a really fast evolution. You know, this is what it was before with endless asphalt, you know, and it, to a thriving plaza just with these temporary materials. And this is the permanent construction. And we're opening it up in phases, so you may have seen some of the final design that's been there. And it's really been a big success with New Yorkers. You know, New Yorkers are very crabby about Times Square. They wouldn't be caught dead there. And now, you know, surveys have found that 74% of New Yorkers found that Times Square to be dramatically improved. And this is what it's going to look like in the final reconstruction when it wraps up. And I invite all of you, since you like coming to New York, a personal invitation. You can say that I've invited you personally to come to New York and check out the reconstruction work. But it really has remade the image of New York. Really simply, and we just started with traffic cones and these beach chairs. And I actually have one of the original beach chairs in my office to this day. It's like a little piece of New York City history. You can probably, if you're interested, you can go on eBay, and they actually have them on eBay. So, and you know, you're seeing this kind of approach now pop up all over the country. This is LA. You know there is a seismic shift going on when LA is doing this kind of work. And this is in front of their Grand Central Market. New pedestrian space in Philadelphia. This is Mi Plaza in the heart of Mexico City, the Zocalo. So clearly this language of sustainable streets is universal. And this new blueprint for cities is about building in more ways for people to get around. It's not anti-car, it is pro-choice. Yes, I could go on in that, but I will not. And you know, people are not going to walk or bike if they don't feel safe doing so. You know, and in that way, safety and sustainability go hand in hand. And that's particularly true for biking. And so we put a big focus on a really strong biking infrastructure. And you know, we took streets like these, which were really all, you know, look at this. This is like bike at your own risk. And transform them into these. And I want to underscore that these projects have a dramatic impact that go well beyond the bike lane. In fact, when we put in protected lanes, injuries to everyone fell 50%. Not just cyclists. And we saw retail sales increase 50% every time we put down these protected lanes. So these projects are part of an economic development strategy for your city. And you know, every street is different, so we created different designs tailored to different streets. You know, on streets without enough room for a buffer, we did high visibility paint. On wider streets, we would put in protected lanes. We put in two-way lanes to connect the network as much as possible. And we did this all over the city, taking advantage of the infrastructure we had, whether it was medians, and you can see Allen Street in Lower Manhattan. This is actually one of my very favorite projects, First Avenue, which was this wild west of traffic before. And we ended up putting in a protected bike lane, three lanes of moving traffic, a dedicated bus lane. You know, when we did this, and I rode this on the first day of City Bike, when City Bike launched, it was just incredible. You know, you're riding in a protected lane on your new bike, and, you know, the traffic is moving, and the buses are flowing, and the birds are singing, and the rainbows are out, and it's just, like, unbelievable. And so I just love doing that. So, anyway. It was a great new design, 40% reduction in injuries, bike ridership doubled. I will say it wasn't just a march to victory. There were some bumps along the way. When you push the status quo pushes right back. And this was kind of ground zero for the pushback. This is It's hard, you wouldn't think that this was actually a war zone here, right? But this is actually Prospect Park West, one of the most famous bike lanes in the world. Before, it was this really dangerous speedway before the community asked us to fix it. And so we did. We put in a protected bike lane, two-way bike lane, reduced the number of speeding cars by 75%, bike ridership tripled. But it became this political football. And so, you know, this became, one paper called it the most contested slab of concrete outside the Gaza Strip. Really? Unbelievable. So, but the success of the project outlasted the headlines. It was a total home run. And, but you know, it's interesting because, you know, we all have these, we hear these myths. And one of the most common complaints that we heard is that more bikes on the street would lead to more crashes and make it more dangerous, when in fact, the complete opposite is true. The more bikes on the streets, the safer your streets are. There is truth to the maxim, safety in numbers. So if you want a safer city, you need to build bike lanes. So we did. In 7 years, we built 400 miles of on-street bike lanes. This is 2007, and this is 2013. And again, it just looks so easy when you do it this way. Just easy. And I can't say enough about the advocates that supported us, the people in the community that fought for Prospect Park West bike lanes, and others like Eric McClure, Paul Steely White in Transportation Alternatives, Brad Lander, Clarence at Street Films. You have that here. You have people like Bagshaw, as I like to call her. You've got Cascade Bike. You've got an amazing mayor. You've got an amazing commissioner. You know, you, all of you in this room are an incredibly powerful force. And we found that at the end of the day, people were way ahead of the press, and they were way ahead of the politicians. And if you look at the polls, this is the polls at the end of the Bloomberg administration, you see unbelievable support for bike lanes, bike share, pedestrian plazas. And if this had been an election, it would have been a landslide in support of sustainable streets. And so today, you're seeing city planners around the world adopt these kinds of tools and strategies on their streets. This is Atlanta. You're seeing it in Denver, Indianapolis, which has, you know, been this big biking center in the heart of the Midwest, Vancouver, Pittsburgh, Austin, and right here at home in Seattle, where Mayor Murray is looking to build 50 miles of protected bike lanes. I think all these cities are showing that you can have walking, biking, and transit work together if you don't make them fight over the scraps. And of course, nothing excites a city of would-be bikers than a new bike share system. And as Scott mentioned, we launched 330 stations, 7,000 bikes actually. And 2 years after launch, we have had New Yorkers take 15 million trips, and they've ridden 15 million miles. It looks really easy. This picture is really funny because actually, you know, we had a lot of press around, you would imagine. And almost all of the time in the pictures, I'm standing like this. Because I'm just praying it works, right? Because, you know, you think about it, if it doesn't work, you know, if the mayor doesn't pull it out of the system, somehow something does go wrong, it's, you know, it can be daunting. But it was a huge home run, and I think one of the major reasons for the success was the public involvement in the siting process. We launched this online portal where New Yorkers made their suggestions for where they wanted the stations to be. 65,000 New Yorkers put in their suggestions. And one of the key pieces to the success of the system was its density, stations every one or two blocks. How many of you have taken the City Bike system? Okay, so we know what you need to do when you come back next time. So it's so having it be very easy to get a bike, drop off a bike, no worries there, and having it close to transit, those were two really key components of that system. And I think there's a great potential for the success of the Pronto system here. How many of you use the Pronto system? And how many of you want the system to be bigger? Good, I like that. It is a great program. We've got over 35 cities in the United States have a bike share system, and it's important to note not a single fatality in any of those cities with any bike share system riders. And I think something to keep in mind here is that successful systems in the United States don't have mandatory helmet laws, which, you know, depress ridership, and more riders on the streets is one of the main drivers of street safety. And I really don't think that cities should put a cap on their potential, styrofoam cap or otherwise. Had to have that role. So, for all of the headlines that bike projects gin up, it's easy to forget that they are one of the most cost-effective investments that you can make. You know, the plaza and bike projects were less than 1% of our budget, and yet they did yield about 99% of our press coverage. But they are projects that any city can afford to tackle. Big city, small city, in fact, no city can afford not to tackle these kinds of projects. And that's because we are not going to build our way out of congestion with more roads. We need to make the assets that we have more efficient. And that's what we did in New York with the Select Bus Service Program, which is New York's version of BRT. We rolled out 7 lines in all 5 boroughs in 6 years, providing high-quality bus rapid transit service in neighborhoods that hadn't seen any kind of progress in decades. So it was real-time mobility. Again, it wasn't perfect. You know, it's not the perfect gold, platinum, BRT line, but it made a huge difference in the lives of thousands and thousands of New Yorkers quickly, and we did it with just off-board fare collection, transit signal priority, giving the bus the green light, holding it longer, dedicated bus lanes that were enforced with cameras. So if a car is driving in the bike lane, in the bus lane, it gets a ticket. And it was a huge, yes, that was a big part of the success. So it's a great strategy. And it's important to show that it can be done. Again, you know, New York has the largest bus fleet in North America, and yet it has the slowest bus speeds. In fact, every year there's a competition on 34th Street between the bus and a person on a trike. And we know who wins every year, you know, and my chief traffic engineer used to say that the only way to get across town was to be born there. Just like, not a great strategy. So, you know, you've got this great backbone of light rail and bus rapid transit and great potential, you know, with BRT on Madison Street and others. And, you know, we found that just like our plaza and bike projects, they generated more foot traffic. And retail sales increased 71% along the bus rapid transit corridor that we put in on Fordham Road. And it just puts a few more holes in the myth that, you know, in order to have economic development, you need to have free parking and traffic, because cars don't shop at stores, people do. So these projects don't stop at the curb. We need to create streets that are friendly and attractive and inviting and have a sense of aesthetics. Looks like somebody cares about them. So we brought that new design approach to bus shelters, to our bike parking shelters, to newsstands and benches. We did a survey a few years ago and we found out that, you know, while New York was a great walking city, there was literally no place to sit down. You know, people, you see this, right? Because you've been there. You see people perched on the fire hydrants or the stoop, you know, just trying to get a little piece of the action to watch, you know, the world go by. So we put out we did a design competition. These are beautiful benches. Put 1,000 of them around the city in the places that needed the most, really focused with the Department of Health on seniors and transit stops. We launched a design competition for bike racks. I really hated our bike racks. They looked like a crazed plumber had put them in, you know, weird, like, inverted U's into the street, bizarre. Now we've got these beautiful bike racks. Put 8,000 of them in. And we also worked on improving the navigation of our streets. With this new wayfinding program, we also did another survey, work for a data-driven mayor, so a lot of surveys, a lot of data. This one survey we did, it turns out that New Yorkers are lost 10% of the time. You know, and that's just the 10% that would admit it. So you've probably experienced that personally. So we created a comprehensive system that gave people confidence, you know, when they're walking around. You know, we all tend to have this mental map of our streets. You know, we walk in certain areas and we rarely go beyond that. And so, you know, unlocking the potential of exploring new neighborhoods and, you know, opening up wallets, you know, as you, you know, see new things going by, it's a great program. And we have this suite of signs that fit into all dimensions of city streets. Same design vocabulary as our bus shelters, our bike shelters, and bike share. We also put in real-time information on our select bus service routes. And with 6,000 miles of streets and 12,000 miles of sidewalks, there's a lot of canvas to play with, you know? And in fact, I always talk about how with 6,000 miles of streets, we're the largest, DOT is the largest real estate developer in New York. And in fact, I think we're like the largest art gallery in the city. And so we worked very hard to look at our streets as showcases for local artists and designers. And we partnered to bring new life to these new spaces and also created new opportunities for people to enjoy and see their streets in a whole new way. How many of you have been to Summer Streets? Oh, okay. Well, come in August and you can enjoy 7 miles of car-free streets from the Brooklyn Bridge to Central Park. And it's great. We program it, dance classes, all sorts of cool activities. We did kickboxing the first year, which was fantastic. I ended up taking a kickboxing class with the deputy mayor that I reported to. Very cathartic. Highly, highly encourage that. You know, and we had some fun along the way. We did zip line programs. We did pop-up pools. You could swim in the shadow of Grand Central. These dumpster pools, very, very popular. Still love those. And we played with our bridges. You know, we art installations on the Manhattan Bridge, worked with Jersey barriers on our protected bike lanes, even just pedestrian, horrible generic fencing around construction sites. And looked at opportunities to create spaces that really enlivened our neighborhoods. We also commissioned artists to take our streets in new directions. We did a design competition for Times Square. This is by Molly Dilworth. It's called Hot Island, Cool Water Hot Island, and it actually is from a NASA heat signature map of Manhattan, which is projected down. Very, very cool. And of course, a big part of the new road order includes measuring the impact of projects. And one of our first was our pedestrian safety and action plan. And it was the largest ever done in the US. We analyzed 7,000 crashes. And the study really became our Rosetta Stone for safety. It was the who, what, why, when, and where of traffic crashes. And it really informed our strategies, our investment programs going forward. And our goal was to reduce traffic fatalities by 50%. We were the first city to really have a target number rather than just a vague notion that we wanted to reduce traffic fatalities. We've seen great success in cities moving beyond that to Vision Zero. Mayor de Blasio is doing that. Mayor Murray and Scott have endorsed that. And I think it's extremely important to help steer public attitudes on traffic violence. You can see this is our map of work. We redesigned 137 corridors and 113 intersections. Great results, 30% decline in traffic fatalities since 2001. But we didn't stop with safety. We also measured the economic performance of our investments and measured the streets. I'm not going to go through it. You can find it online. It's a really important piece of work in terms of analyzing the impact of your projects from the economic development perspective. We also use technology to better manage our streets, and so we actually coordinated traffic signals to real-time conditions on the streets, measuring the effect through taxi GPS devices. We had taxi GPS devices in all 13,000 yellow cabs in the city. All of these design strategies were incorporated into a new street design code for New York, and it's not the most sexy project, but is one of the most important projects that we did. We had 11 different city agencies that touched the street in some way, and they all had different standards for what they were requiring on their streets. And so we came together, it took 2 years, and now we have this unified approach. It's the new playbook, the new operating code for New York City streets. Anybody in the private or public sector that touches the streets has to use this guide. And we're seeing these kinds of design standards adopted all over the world, thanks to NACDO's Urban Street Design and Bikeway Design Guide. NACDO, the National Association of City Transportation Officials. How many know about NACDO? Excellent. Excellent. How many of you have a guide? Oh, that's just fabulous. I really think maybe about moving here. This is really, really good. Really good. So you know that this is the core of the new vision. It really is about prioritizing people on 2 feet and 2 wheels in transit above cars. It really flips that old hierarchy on its head. It takes street designs like this and prioritizes balance and mobility and safety. And you know, thanks to Mayor Murray and Scott, Seattle DOT, you know, Seattle is already starting down this road. And it's really exciting to see what's happening here, from the new bus rapid transit and streetcar projects to the new protected bike lanes. And it's true that some people will balk at the cost, and some people will balk at the ideas or say, just can't happen here. And I think that this mindset of despair and disrepair is a result of the status quo that we've come to accept on our streets, and we need to break the cycle of wasted opportunity. Hallelujah! You know, and these strategies and projects aren't just nice things to have. They're not just amenities. They're critical to the economic development, to the safety, and the quality of life of this city. You know, and Seattle draws people who are wired to take risks. I mean, this is really one of the nation's capitals of innovation, and you can tap into that energy and discover what is possible on your streets. Try new things, take risks, create a new future for Seattle, reinvent it from the street up. Now is the time. You have the vision, you have the political leadership. You know, and with the energy and commitment of everyone in this room, you can make it happen. You have to make it happen. You can and you must. Thank you.
Do a little rearranging up here and move aside the screen and get some chairs up because we have Mayor Ed Murray with us and Scott Kubly from Seattle Transportation. But I did have a couple of questions I wanted to kind of get started with. You talked about not everything working, and we always learn also from the things that don't work. And you talked about trying to do these projects really quickly and prototype them. What did you learn that didn't work?
Well, it wasn't so much that the strategies didn't work, but you have to be very, I think, careful and opportunistic where you're trying new things and working in communities where there's an appetite for this kind of change. One community where we were putting in this bike lane on Bedford Avenue in a very Hasidic part of Williamsburg didn't really like the bike lanes. In fact, the big fear, this was in the papers, was that the girls in flirty skirts were going to be riding in these bike lanes. And so we actually ended up, we never really took the bike lane out, but we created a much better connection. And so I think it's about being flexible and tailoring the projects, because a lot of times you need to make adjustments. They don't go in perfect, you know? So you may need to change parking, you may need to change the hours, signals. You know, it's about massaging it to get it right.
What was the hardest thing to change?
question. Lots of things were hard. I think changing the expectation for what can happen on city streets was a big cultural change. You know, I think that the idea that our streets could be more than parking lots and, you know, speedways for cars, that was a huge sea change. And so moving, that's why we moved so quickly to try to show what the new possibilities of it were. But, you know, people get really entrenched. So changing the status quo, it's really hard. You know, it's worth it, but it's hard. Can you see the scars back there? That's why I wear black leather these days. Hides a lot of sins.
Oh, that was my next question.
About the black leather?
Yeah, about the black leather. you talked about a lot of fun, cool, sexy stuff, but a basic thing about transportation is the infrastructure. And civil engineers have said, countrywide, our infrastructure is in a big mess. Mm-hmm. Roads are declining. They're getting to the point where it's going to cost a whole lot more because they'll have to be rebuilt rather than just fix them. Yep. We've got some issues like that here in Seattle. I wondered if that was on the list of issues that you had to face, your crumbling infrastructure, and how you dealt with that.
No, absolutely. In fact, we would not have been able to make the innovative, do the innovative work that we did if we hadn't taken care of the basics. So whether it's potholes, whether it's state of good repairs on our bridges, we prioritize that. And so we put $6 billion basically into our bridges under Mayor Bloomberg over his tenure. And so out of all of the 788 bridges, they were all at the end of the tenure in a state of good repair, which is unlike any other city in the United States. So it does take a commitment. We're seeing that the federal government is actually shrinking its commitment to infrastructure, and states are struggling. And so really it's about cities stepping up to the plate and doing what they can to, you know, address this shortfall. But it's a crisis, and the economic future of our country depends on it. We're spending like 2% GDP on, you know, infrastructure. You see, Europe is at 5, Asia's at 7. You know, we're falling behind, and until Washington sort of wakes up to that fact and starts investing, you know, we're going to continue to find ourselves in a big hole that we have to dig ourselves out of. But we were really happy to see the progress that we were able to make under Mayor Bloomberg, because he really got it, and he understood that the success of the future really depended on a healthy infrastructure.
I know this wasn't necessarily a goal, but and New York City is already a big commuting city. People don't drive everywhere the way they do in a lot of other places. But did you see a drop in people driving cars through these innovations?
Well, we saw more and more people taking advantage of bus rapid transit and bikes and walking. But you know, you already have a third of New Yorkers get around by walking, a third take transit, and a third drive. So we have a really pretty good share of people that are actually getting around other ways. So we didn't have a percent, you know, we didn't know what the percentage change is actually, but we saw more and more people out there. And when you take a look at the number of people that are using the bike share, that are using the buses, that are walking, you know, it's probably more anecdote than analytical, but it was definitely, you know, you saw a steep curve.
I'd like to invite Mayor Murray and Scott Kubly to the stage. Scott and Mayor, you've heard her presentation, and I'm sure you know about some of this stuff to start with. What do you see as the, and you're doing some of this already, but what the stuff you're not doing would you like to do, and what stuff are you doing that you'd like to expand based on what we just saw Janette talk about happening in New York?
Sure. First of all, thank you for being here. Welcome. My apology for being a little late. I want to begin by acknowledging Councilmember Bagshaw and Councilmember O'Brien. Maybe you all could stand and be recognized. And speaking of the City Council, it was 25 years ago that I went to work for Martha Cho when she was elected to the council and staffed her as she chaired the council's Transportation Committee. I went on, as many of you know, to chair the House Transportation Committee in the legislature. So it's interesting, you mentioned something about a project in a Hasidic area of Brooklyn. The first project I worked on for Martha was on William Street in South Seattle, and it had to deal with the Orthodox synagogues and the need for pedestrian crossings that you didn't have to push the light. So to answer your question, first of all, thank you all for being here. This is very, very exciting. And as you picked up, I'm a transportation nerd. And, you know, a department head's biggest fear is the mayor will actually be interested in his area most. So pity Scott. You know, this is a city over many, many years that has put some things in place and done some things right over many mayors and over many councils. I think the thing that impressed me about New York when I've gone back during your tenure, and I've been going there since I was a kid, my mother was born and raised in the city. If New York can get pedestrian and bicycling right, if bicycling, and for those of you who are old enough and can think about Manhattan decades ago, you would never think it would go further than Seattle being a bicycling city. And the pedestrian amenities, and quite honestly, getting parks right and getting active space right. So while I think Seattle gets those things right, we haven't taken it to scale. And we certainly, as you've heard from me as part of this plan, we haven't integrated it. And that's going to be our biggest challenge going forward. And whether it's pedestrian, whether it's bicycle, whether it's the ability of cars when we need a car to move through the city, we've got a lot of work to do. But we did a lot of things right in a very short period of time over the last 15 months, from passing the largest bus transit package since Metro was created in the 1970s. Thank you very much. Jump-starting bike share and moving the cycle track on 2nd Avenue up by a year and a half. But some of the things we have to deal with going forward are maybe not immediately obvious. Scott and I met with about 15 immigrant and minority organizations. They had very different things to say about what they were looking for in transportation, and they had very different needs. And I'm gonna mention this because it kind of gets to your question. Actually, there wasn't a great deal of excitement about bicycling at all. And I spent some time with folks after that meeting digging down on that. Cycling means something very different to many immigrant communities about what it symbolizes than it does maybe to the majority of the people in this city who were born here. And the need to get to work or get to daycare fast often means not coming from a neighborhood to the central city where there's good bus service, but going from a neighborhood when you're getting a job after you've been unemployed, probably to a strip mall where a car is necessary. So as we look at what New York does, those are some of the things I think we need to get right, is listen to other communities who have not traditionally been part of the discussion around transportation.
So I think the thing that I picked up from Janette's talk that I really appreciate, and I will say that having a mayor that really is a self-professed transportation nerd is actually a really exciting thing. It's actually one of the best parts about the job is having a person that you work for that understands the work that you're trying to do and actually can teach you how to do it better. So I think that's really...
He's being kind.
I'm also being sincere. So, but I think the thing that I really enjoyed hearing Janette talk about was not necessarily any individual project, but this notion that we don't have to be perfect, right? Which I think, you know, the folks that I work with, a lot of them really strive for perfection, which I think is a very laudable goal. But this notion that going out and trying something, and maybe it works, and maybe it doesn't, but maybe it's amazing, is a really powerful lesson, and I think has changed the way I certainly approach my job, and I think a lot of other people do in this field.
A follow-up to that, the idea that you should innovate quickly, try stuff out, if it doesn't work, go ahead and take it apart and redo it in a different way. We live in a city that's known for its process. Do you think that in Seattle you could put beach chairs out on Pine Street next to Westlake Park and just try that out?
So. So I'm from here, so I get process, but I also believe we have a lot of catch up to do, and we need to move fast, we need to move quick, we need to be willing to take risks. But here's the deal, folks, and this is sometimes really hard in our ultra-liberal culture. We need to take risks and allow people to make mistakes so we can figure out what works and what doesn't work. And that's sometimes where we are absolutely not willing to let folks take those experiments, say, hey, it didn't work, let's try something else. But we absolutely have to. We cannot wait because we have to do catch up.
Are there any ideas like that that you guys might be brewing up?
Oh, yeah.
What? Scott, could you tell us about them?
Oh, wow. I'd like to tell my boss first. But I like not to surprise him too much. I'll talk about one that that's underway right now, which is the Roosevelt Avenue bike lane that we're working on, which I think is a really exciting opportunity for us to try and get projects right, and it's not been without some pain internally, you know, trying to figure out how we get the whole department to work together to deliver a great street really quickly. And you know, we went out there in early November as we were just piloting it, and we just put some paint out and put some delineators out so that we could actually see how it was working and demonstrate something to the community while we were out there working on a new design.
I want to ask the boring infrastructure question. I got a chance to go out with a Seattle Department of Transportation employee and look at the Fairview Bridge. Does everybody know there's a bridge on Fairview Avenue? Yeah, there is, and it's apparently kind of decrepit and falling apart. It's still safe, but you can't drive big trucks on it because it needs to get fixed. And I know it's one of the items that's going to be in the referendum coming up to pay for its fixing. But on a larger scale, is there a plan to get Seattle ahead of the game when it comes to fixing our infrastructure rather than just piddling around on the edges and continually falling further and further behind with a bigger backlog?
Well, the answer is yes, and that's why the package is somewhat shocking in its size. But I will have to say something else. We've had a conversation, and you heard how cities can be innovators, but cities and states are not going to be able to get on top of the transportation issue, or quite honestly, the homeless issue, among others, until we have a re-engaged federal partner. We simply cannot finance this by ourselves. Many of the major structures in the city were originally built and paid for by the federal government, and until they come in, the answer is there's a lot we can do, and this thing is so big, we're gonna do a big move to get on top of things, but we're gonna need to have other partners.
I was gonna ask Janette how she tackled those sorts of issues in New York, because it was a city that has infrastructure that is bridges that are hundreds of years old and was growing. I think 1 million people got added in the last 10 years or 12 years or so. So how did you guys tackle it?
Well, we did everything we could to wring money out of the federal government. So we were pretty opportunistic in our applications for funds. I actually used to work at the U.S. Department of Transportation and handled the transit portfolio. So we had a pretty ambitious program of applications for bus rapid transit, for fixing our passenger ferry terminal. We had the largest stimulus project in New York State funded. So I think part of it is actually following, getting as much as you can out of it. You know, in every single category. You know, New York actually has, we have so many bridge needs that Congress actually put a bridge cap, 10% bridge cap on federal funding that we could have. So, you know, you have to, we have to be very careful there in terms of additional sources. And I do think that we are going to have a much bigger commitment from the federal government, but I also think that we are going to have to look for different ways of financing infrastructure. So some of our transit extensions were paid for by TIFs, and so looking at ways of capturing land value associated with property value increases when you put in a transit expansion, a new transit project, we're going to have to look to those kinds of strategies going forward.
That's a very good point, and we as a state have some challenges. You heard how New York dealt with some of their major infrastructure projects. Portland financed part of its light rail system to the airport in a public-private partnership. With a land exchange at, I believe it was Port Property. TIF and that public-private partnership in Portland, in the state of Washington, we don't have those tools. So we are very constrained in looking at innovative ways to finance transportation in this state. And I'm not telling you that so much as I'm telling you all that, because it's a discussion that we need to have.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about the funding part of it and the kind of constraints that the city of Seattle works under, that the state of Washington works under without a revenue stream like an income tax, is that really strangle the funnel of money available to do transportation?
Well, I mean, the answer is yes. I mean, we are now in a structural budget problem in the city of Seattle, even though we've come out of the recession. But the 1% Tim Iman cap on property taxes, the loss of all those revenues that used to go to transportation when 695 went away in the 1990s, has finally caught up with us. And we're bumping up against a future problem if there is not change in how we finance government in the state of Washington.
I want to open it up to the audience questions in just a couple of moments, but Scott Kubly and Mayor Murray, what do you see as the most difficult piece of this package to get accomplished as you go into it? What's going to be the hardest thing to get done?
I don't necessarily know that there will be one hardest thing to get done. I think it's going to be, well, from the outreach that we've done, we've heard from thousands of different people at this point through all sorts of different mediums. And I think it's really getting as many different things in there as we've heard from folks. You know, folks talk about how much they want more sidewalks, better sidewalks in all parts of the city. That's a $2.5 billion problem for the city of Seattle to put sidewalks where we don't have them right now. So I think the biggest challenge is, you know, how do we satisfy these needs that we have with a package that is the size that we have?
Hey, who wants to ask a question? Step right up to these microphones, and please, please put it in the form of a question, if you possibly can.
I have to beg for just a minute. I've been back in Seattle since 2001. I was here throughout the 80s. When I got back here, I was shocked. I was shocked at how shitty Metro is. Now, how many people here ride Metro every day? See what I mean? You have SUVs. You support the oil industry. You ride these ridiculous, huge SUVs all over the place.
I won't use an audio word again. A question from your comment?
My question is, what Seattle needs is a serious promotion. My question is, what did you do to promote getting people to get back on bikes? Was it a serious promotional project? Because that's what we need here.
Well, that's a good question. How do you make buses attractive to people to get them to buses, right?
Well, you have to make, I live on Broadway.
No, I got it. That's what I was going to do. So one of the things that you can't wish people onto buses, just like, woo, we would like to have more people take buses. And you can't do an ad campaign that's going to get people on buses. You actually have to provide high quality service to get people on buses. And so that's what we did. We focused on in areas of high ridership and high demand. We laid out an entire strategy, citywide strategy, to connect it all together. And then we made it happen. We put those lanes in. We got it done. And that's what happened. That's why we had a 10% increase in ridership at a time when city bus ridership was going down 5%. So when you build better lines and you build better service, people will come.
That's absolutely correct.
Scott, so, did you want to add to that?
Yeah, I was going to say, right now there's about 25% of the city that's within a 5-minute, 10-minute walk of 10-minute or more frequent bus service. And I think what gets people on buses is the same thing that draws people to any product, which is reliable service that they can depend on. And so with Proposition 1 that passed in November, we're going to be able to get to 50% of the city is within a 10-minute walk of 10-minute bus service, and that's huge. And then with the levy investments, it's going to make all of those bus routes more reliable. It's going to do speed and reliability improvements. So the buses come more frequently, and when they are coming, they're moving faster.
Reliability is a very important thing.
Thank you for your question.
Sir?
We have a few other people who
would
like to ask questions.
There's a lot of other people that want to ask questions.
Can we go over to this side of the room? Could you tell me your name and ask your question, please?
Yes, mine is Phil Brazel. I have a question for Janette. I did notice you mention anything about barrier-free access for mobility impaired. Some people say disabled. I'm sure you did. Could you briefly describe how you were able to maintain or improve access for the mobility impaired and all the transportation improvements you made.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, I worked, actually, the first mayor I worked for was Mayor Dinkins. And he had this philosophy that I think is so smart, and it's become my philosophy, which is that we're all temporarily able, right? And when you look at it from that perspective, it completely changes how you design your city. And so all of the projects that we have, you know, we spend a lot of time making our sidewalks more accessible. We have transit accessibility issues. Still, we have 65 key stations out of 469 subway stations in New York, so that's a big capital need, but we're moving forward in getting that done. We had a really interesting conversation with a variety of disabled communities when it came to changing the streets. So we had these temporary plazas that we had there, and we changed, you know, how people navigated. And so we worked very closely with the community to figure out different strategies that would work with them. So, you know, we put in different kinds of notification, really sort of street signals, as we were making the kinds of changes that we were doing in the streets. So accessible taxi cab fleet, accessible sidewalks, accessible transportation, and then trying to work to make sure that the existing infrastructure and the new infrastructure are as accessible as possible. It could be everything from lights. You know, we worked on that, priority lights and audio warnings. And so it's an ongoing thing. But I don't look at it as a one-off thing, as a thing that's in the corner. I look at it as part of everyday work.
Let's go back over here. Your names and your questions, sir.
Hey, my name's Jeff. This question's for Janette. So I grew up in New York on 64th and 1st. I was there for about 25 years, and it's been awesome seeing the changes that the city has experienced.
Lean a little bit closer to that.
Sorry, I don't typically ask questions. Anyway, it's awesome that you're here. It's exciting to hear all these things. My question's about culture, and what I've noticed is that going back to New York to visit my family, bikers are extremely aggressive there. Most of them don't wear helmets. Most of them don't have lights. Whereas here, I mean, I bike myself, and I find that there's more a culture around safety and respecting like other cyclists and pedestrians. So I'm wondering about the culture for bicyclists that you're experiencing there and how you change the sort of the attitude of safety. Mm-hmm. And then the other question also related to that is, because of all of these changes, I've noticed that over the last 25 years, traffic has become more or less atrocious. Like even at like 3 in the morning coming home, like traffic is at a standstill.
And you're talking about here?
No. This is all in New York, okay. Sorry. And like I go to my dad's office on 3rd and 44th.
That's two questions. It's one question
they're,
per
they're
customer.
They're both related to culture and all the changes that you're making. And I think that you come home from work and I'm walking down 33rd Avenue and it's like traffic is horrible. Nobody wants to walk on 3rd Avenue because of the traffic. And you added a bike lane on 3rd Avenue, you added a bike lane on 1st Avenue. So basically now these two avenues going uptown are congested. And so it's actually pretty unpleasant to walk. And so I'm wondering what you're doing about the traffic situation as well for cars.
I think that's like five questions in there.
Sorry.
I'll try.
Answer the last one or pick whichever one.
So the culture thing is an interesting one. You've actually seen a complete change in who's biking in New York City. It used to be like people, young men like you, Lycra, bandolier bike chains strapped across, zooming through, right? You know, that was basically the profile of a biker in New York City. And now, you know, it's as diverse as, you know, the people in the city, all sorts of different kinds of stripes. So that has changed. Who is cycling has changed. And that's because we've built a protected and effective bike infrastructure. Because people feel safe riding bikes now, whereas before it was kind of like this daredevil thing, right? In fact, I used to get letters from people that thought I was ruining the biking experience by making it safe. The thrill was gone. So, you know, I mean, everybody's got 8 million people in New York, 9 million opinions. So, you know, I'm used to that at this point in time. But, so we worked very, very hard on that.
But it does take a while to change the culture, right? That people following the rules of the road. And cyclists in New York are not, you know, they are a little bit, you know, aggressive. And so we actually did a big public education campaign, and in typical New York, you know, form, we called it Don't Be a Jerk. And we had a big Don't Be a Jerk campaign. And we had, you know, famous artists and cooks and models and everybody. John Leguizamo was hilarious, you know, riding the wrong way on a bike lane and people screaming. And so you have to play with it a little bit, right, you know, to sort of get it through. If you just did a public safety campaign that said, follow the rules of the road, you know, nobody's going to be listening to you. So you got to break through. So we changed the infrastructure. We changed the safety profile by putting in a healthy network. And then, you know, I hate to say it, but a lot of people think that traffic has gotten worse, right? It's very anecdotal. And we worked very hard on moving from anecdote to analysis. And so that's why we were actually able to show that traffic wasn't worse, because we have taxi GPS devices in all the 13,000 cabs, 1.2 million records a month that we take a look at. And, you know, even Mayor Bloomberg, you know, he was very skeptical of some of the early projects that we were going to be doing. We had this floating car technique where you sort of drive a project before, you know, and then you drive the project afterwards. And he was convinced that, like, my drivers were going to, like, be flooring it to be able to show just exactly how fast and how much better the project was. And when we had the taxi GPS data, we can't do anything about that. That's the data is what the data is, and the data shows that traffic is working at least as well, if not better, than before. So I don't know what's going on Third Avenue or your dad's office, but, you know, I'm hoping it's going to improve. But I'm glad you're a New Yorker, and thanks for coming.
Let's go over here for our next question, singular.
Can I just say, sure. I would, can you imagine that campaign in Seattle, Don't Be a Jerk?
Hi, thank you so much for coming to Seattle. We really need this inspiration. I just wondered if you would give us an idea of your vision of, if you were to imagine a city in the future that's really gotten the livability thing down, like how would those modalities, the ratio of different modalities break down in transportation? I mean, I'm thinking like, imagine 500 years in the future. Do you think we'll still have cars, or will we be?
Wow, 500 years.
Personally,
I guess that assumes we'll be here
I'm
500
just,
years.
You know,
I'm teleporting then, right? We have no cars. We're just zoop. I'm still into the Star Trek vision for the future, you know. So, that's how that goes. But I think in the nearer term. I think having a lot of options and making it easy for everybody to get around as seamlessly as possible. People want to be able to walk to work, walk to jobs, get around safely, have great places, you know, to be. I think that there's an interesting piece that's going on with instant mobility with smartphones now, right, where you can order up a car like that or a bus like that or a van like that. I do think that we have to be careful a little bit, because I don't think that government is quite caught up with the technology in the sense of setting the right framework. Because in New York, for example, I love Uber, I love Lyft, I love all these services, but we have 13,000 yellow cabs in New York, and now we have 14,000 Ubers. So we have to be very careful when we're designing these systems that we're not actually going back and creating more problems, you know, sort of back to the future kind of situations, and making sure that the land use implications don't lead to more sprawl, because there are more ways to get there. So, but I'm very, very hopeful about what's happening, because I think that transportation is completely transforming, and I do think that it's going to be almost like mobility in your pocket, and you're going to get to where you need to go. But I am with you on teleporting.
Let's go over to this side now. Your name, sir, and your question.
Gifford Jones, and these are all very exciting changes and something that most of us can embrace. But I'm here to beg for some others that are not able to embrace this. I'm closing in on my 80s, and I still ride my bike but not all of my friends in my generation are able to, are willing to tackle our hills around here, our traffic, our weather. This is not typical of Seattle. It rains here, we have steep hills. We have members of my generation who need to attend to medical care, and shopping is not as easily accomplished. So I feel as though the people that are in beyond the bicycling generation have been left behind and kind of dropped under the bus.
How do we deal with the fact that we're all temporarily able-bodied?
Beg your pardon?
How do we deal with all the people who are not able-bodied now?
Well, that's my question to the panel.
Yes.
And I feel like we've been left out. Thank you.
So I think one of the things that Janette mentioned was all that data that showed that crashes go down for everybody. And I have a really bad back, so everybody who works with me knows that a couple weeks ago I was hobbling around and I was temporarily losing my temporary ability. And what I noticed as I was crossing streets was it was really hard for me to make it all the way across the street with the allotted time for the walk signal. And I think that's something that as you're younger, as you're older, that becomes more and more challenging. And one of the things that just a protected bike lane can do, which you saw in all the photos that Janette put up there, is that the dirty little secret is it actually makes it safer for the pedestrians more than anybody else. And it does that because it shortens the crossing distance. And it actually makes it easier to walk across the street. So if you go down on 2nd Avenue right now, it's actually easier to cross the street because you're crossing less street.
But you make a very, very important point. And one of the things I've tried to emphasize is whether it's bikes or any other part of our transportation system, it has to be for all abilities in all ages. And you know, that was brought home. And it's got to be a lot of little things that make a huge difference when they add up. It was brought home to me a few years ago. I tore my meniscus, which I didn't even know I had one, and had surgery. And I rode the bus when I wasn't in Olympia. And climbing up the stairs of our buses, I can't imagine being old. And I know Metro is working, and we want to encourage them to speed this up, that we have buses that you can step off the sidewalk and walk right onto the bus. Those sorts of things, the things we're trying to do to build out our pedestrian infrastructure, those sorts of things make the difference for people of various ages and various abilities.
Your name and your question.
My name is Heather, and I'm very lucky to live in Seattle. I love it here. Many people are being priced out of Seattle and can't afford to live here anymore. And I think all the privileged people who get to live in Seattle are lucky, and there are lots of people who are now forced to live outside because they can't afford to and need to get into the city. What are we doing to make our system work for them?
Sure. So the issue of affordability, I've kind of made the cornerstone of what I believe that we need to address as a city. And there's a lot of things we can do. We are the first city in America to raise the minimum wage to the level we'll reach at $15 an hour. San Francisco has, you know, stepped up at that level, and we're hoping this catches fire. Again, a livable wage in San Francisco, I think, would be $27 an hour. $21 an hour in Seattle would be a livable wage. So $15 an hour is a big step there, but it's not there, but it will make a difference for folks who are challenged. I put together a task force similar to the one I put together last year. And again, very short timeline, 5 or 6 months. Right now you can read the same stories about this task force that you could have read about the minimum wage last year. It's stuck, it's not working. It's actually working, people are having a difficult time. But I've committed to, and I've asked the task force to help me figure out how we're gonna finance 50,000 units over the next 10 years, including 20,000 low-income units. San Francisco's goal is about 30,000. Right now, San Francisco produces about total 1,500 units. We produce 3,500 units. So we think that we can actually make a huge dent in this issue of affordability and housing. But it will take a lot of things. The developers have to step up. The public sector will have to step up, as well as the nonprofit sector. So that proposal I hope to send to council. It won't be one knob, the minimum wage. It'll be a series of things that we have to do, and we hope to send that series to council sometime in June.
Janette, did you have anything you could learn?
No, I
mean, I think the mayor is spot on. That's exactly what's going on in New York in terms of looking at minimum wage, in terms of, you know, obviously we're at a different scale in terms of housing, but again, making sure that developers are including affordable housing, changing those ratios, also making it easier for people to get to where they need to go. Cost of a car, $10,000 a year, so you're talking about a lot of money that could be used, you know, in other ways. So as Mayor Murray said, it's a package approach. You have to have a comprehensive approach, and I think that's what smart cities are working on.
Okay, I want to add something I said earlier. As you know, I've tried in the last 15 months to really do an integrated approach, particularly on cycling. But transportation is one of the huge cost factors if you're trying to live and survive. Owning a car is very expensive. Doing things like we did on transit also helps bring down the costs of somebody who is struggling or someone who's at the lower end economically. but again, it's interesting in the meeting Scott and I had, what we heard from communities of color is, well, we don't get the bicycle tracks because we can't afford bicycles. So there's a larger discussion we need to have in this city. There's almost a geographical divide around affordability when it comes to things like bicycles and cars and bus service that we're going to have around transportation.
Next question over here. What's your name and what's your question?
Hi, my name is Justin Resnick with Farron Peers. Thank you so much to the panelists. It's been a fantastic evening. My question revolves around kind of the approach we take to planning our transportation systems. Janette, I think, you know, a couple of the powerful things you said that during your talk, one is don't make other modes fight for the scraps. And you also said, you know, make these changes seem every day. And you change the violence, or the language of the conversation using the term traffic violence around safety needs, which I think is really important. You know, for the longest time we've talked about, especially here in Seattle, the war on cars, wars amongst the modes, and I think in a lot of cities that have kind of gotten it, we've gotten past that. And I'm wondering what you see as the role of kind of the public, the advocate community, in really helping, you know, to move the ball along while maybe not pushing purely the kind of advocacy planning approach that a lot of times can result in, you know, demonizing public opinion and sort of the press you get from that. Where is the role of the advocates and the community in helping this process?
Well, it's a really great question, and you know, we did a huge sea change, made a huge sea change in transportation in New York City, and there was this feeling, there was this meme that was out there that I just like was the Wizard of Oz. It just went whoosh, and it all happened, right? And we didn't talk to the community at all, and in fact, we probably had the most comprehensive public outreach campaign in the city's history on every single one of our projects went through community boards. And so 59 community boards, projects go through, projects get voted on. And what we did was we changed the public involvement process. So instead of coming to say, hey, how about approving this bus lane? We actually started the conversation with, what's the problem you have here? You know, and looked at it that way. What's the problem we're trying to solve? Is your problem, you have a safety problem in the neighborhood, you'd like the bike lane, you know, you want. So we changed the frame of the discussion, and that actually brought more people to the table, got more people involved. It was a very different way of doing outreach. And the communication strategy from the Department of Transportation in the past had been very much, you know, sort of sitting up here, fielding questions, you know, not very engaged at all. And our communications were even worse. It was like somebody would write in and they would want to have, you know, a traffic light, and we would say, no, it doesn't meet the MUTCD. Boom, end of conversation, right? What's that, you know? Like, that's horrible. So, you know, we sort of changed it to like, well, why don't you ask for this, this, or this? And we did a DOT Academy, and we trained local advocates about how to ask for things, I mean, how we'd made our decisions, how we designed our streets. And so they became very much an active part of the process. And I think that's a really important part of how we made the change. And I think it's an important strategy for cities going forward.
Over here, what's your name, sir, and what's your question?
Hi, my name is Jim. I am from Mexico City. I'm visiting Seattle. My question goes toward what are the efforts that are being done in like a more metropolitan perspective. Because like I think like all these efforts are very focused on central city. And the biggest mistake in Mexico City is like, yeah, we have Mi Plaza, and like you walk like a mile out of there, and you're dead. Today, the 10th cyclist died in Mexico City. So what's the approach? I think the corridor like Seattle, Olympia, Tacoma is a great opportunity. And there was a panel a week ago about Sound Transit and Metro like trying to coordinate efforts in like this more wide vision like outside of Seattle. And like if it's gonna grow so much, I think it'll be a great idea to share some of this growth with all these two cities that are together, that are the same part of the same metropolitan area. So what are the efforts in like terms of development, housing, commerce, retail, finance, if they're being done with all these other cities to like share the growth that is expected to happen in the next in the coming years?
Scott, you want to take that one? Oh, sorry. I didn't see the mic had passed hands. Mayor Murray, you sound like you're ready to
answer. I'll let the mayor close this one out. So I think that, you know, you're spot on. One of the things that the mayor makes very clear to us when we're working on transportation is that the economy doesn't stop at the city's border. There's a lot of people that commute in. There's a lot of people that commute out. We, as a region, we're investing a lot in Sound Transit. There's going to be, hopefully, another chance in a 2016 to invest more. So that's really critical. Another thing that we did when we passed Proposition 1, which was the largest bus service addition in King County, was we actually reserved a good chunk of that money that we could, we reserved for other communities to use to help increase bus service in their communities, other cities. Now, they have to bring some money to the table, put some skin in the game, but we wanted to make sure that it was really clear that our transportation system doesn't stop at the city boundary.
Thank you. Over here, next question. What's your name and what's your question?
My name is Amanda, and this question is for Janette. First of all, I grew up in Manhattan also, so thank you so much. It was a great presentation. The reason I stopped biking in New York is because my bike was stolen. And I think that's a very common thing, at least for New Yorkers. Not as much in Seattle, but my question is, I want to know if you have linked any of the data of results from your overall plan and all of the implementation, the new implementations that you had for bike and ped and transportation safety with other intrinsic community benefits like crime reduction, theft reduction, overall health and happiness, and things like that.
So how's transportation connected to those factors?
And if you have that information.
We did a lot of work with the Department of Health. And so, but we were just starting to do that with the public surveys when we left about, you know, so that piece is underway and will be exciting to see what comes of that. But you're right. I mean, there was a big problem with bike thefts. You know, I lost 3 bikes in the city. One of my favorites, too. It was really tragic. I'm still mourning the silver steed. anyway, I got distracted there. but what we found, actually, was that concern, the idea that your bike wouldn't be there at the end of the day was like the number one reason that people weren't biking to work. We did city planning did a study, and that was the finding. And so that actually went a long way to making the case for bike share. And again, we're 7,000 bikes, but this is a city that will have a 20,000 bike system, right? It's going to be every neighborhood. It's going to be all through. And so, you know, and unlike here, I mean, I don't know the size of your apartment. My apartment's small. And so having bikes in the apartment is really tough. So the other piece was, you know, you really do want to be able to have a place to have your bike. So bike share is actually a perfect solution in those kinds of situations. But we've seen crime go. Crime went down under Commissioner Ray Kelly. And so we saw those numbers go down. But again, you know, that had been a big concern, and it's a great question. And figuring out ways to better integrate the data, you know, that we've got to do the analysis that you're talking about is one of the challenges going forward, really important issue. So thank you for that.
I'm sorry, but we've gone over our time, and you do not want to mess with the bouncers at Town Hall. They are badass. So we're going to have to clear out. Thank you so much to our guests, our panelists up here for being here.